Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. Today's episode is sponsored in part by Highland Woodworking. Visit their website at highlandwoodworking.com. And also by Lee Valley and Veritas. Visit their website at leevalley.com.
Hey everybody, welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop Podcast. So for today's episode, we're starting a brand new project, and this is going to be a set of bookshelves that's going along with the child's dresser that we just finished. Now again, because I kind of fell behind on the child's dresser, I'm in a time-sensitive kind of a situation, and I really need to start moving forward on this. So to help speed things along, what I've done is I've already taken the rough lumber, I've milled it, and I've got it to the basic dimensions that I need. Of course, we're going to need to tweak things here and there, but all in all, we're pretty much at the point of assembly with some light joinery going on. Now, in this episode, or in this project, we're going to be doing just some very basic joinery, butt joints, and then I'm going to be reinforcing them, actually, with pocket holes. Now, we don't really use pocket holes that often here, but one thing I do when I do use them is I try to conceal them the best I can. I want them in locations that you're not going to see unless you really go looking for them. So we'll talk a little bit more about that as the joinery comes up. Now, the first thing we need to do, of course, is to figure out what we're going to start gluing up first to get the whole assembly going. And I pretty much have the shelves all set. They're all glued. Like I said, I've already dimensioned those. Now what I want to start with is the side panels themselves. And the side panels are going to be made up of these laminated legs. Now, initially, the plans called for 1.5 by 1.5. But as I often do, and I'm sure many of you do it the same thing, once in a while you kind of alter plans as you go. The main thing, of course, is to make sure that if you do make any alterations, that you account for it throughout the whole entire plan before you take the next step. And so rather than 1.5 by 1.5, we have 1.75 by about 1.5. And so, or is that, yeah, let's take a look. Let's just double check it so that I'm not coming up later on and saying, oh, it's this instead. Yeah, 1.75 by, oh, this is coming in at more like 1.25. And so it's definitely a drastic difference between the 1.5 and 1.5 that we originally had planned on using, but I think it's going to work really great in the final project. Now, the first thing I want to do is I'm going to take two of the laminated legs, and I have a panel that's going to go in between them, so we're going to glue that up. But before we even get to that, one of the things I want to do is, for the shelves, rather than drilling holes in the panels and just using pins to hold them in place, I've decided I'm going to use these uprights right here, these adjustable shelf supports. And so I went out to my local home center and I picked up a couple of these. In fact, we're going to be making two sets of bookshelves, bookcases, and I'm going to need approximately, I'm going to need 8 of these total. So I went ahead and picked up 4, and I'll be able to cut them in half and put them in place, and I'll show you as we go into this. But what I really like about this is, it feels like it's a little bit more secure, and I don't have to worry about, in case the bookshelf gets really, really heavy, potential of tearing out if I just use the simple pins and drilled holes in them. Never had that problem before, but I really like the adjustability of using a pre-manufactured support like this. So the first thing we need to do is to take that panel, and we're going to route 2 stopped grooves, one on each side of the panel itself, because we're going to have 2 of these on each panel, and we're going to be doing that on all 4 panels because we have 2 for each dresser. So let's go ahead and take a look at the footage that we did of that. It's really simple, a matter of just setting up a straight edge guide and then routing the grooves. Perhaps the most important part to remember is to do some layout lines so you know exactly where to start and where to stop. So let's take a look at that.
So once I determined where exactly I want the grooves to start, it was just a matter of marking the top and the bottom. And in this situation, the bottom started a little bit higher up from the end than the top did, and that's mainly because we have a fixed shelf that's going to be put right in that position. So it's important to mark which is the top and which is the bottom, because obviously you don't want that groove going all the way through. Well, at least in this situation, I didn't want it. So I went ahead and I marked it. Then using my tri-square, I went ahead, made those lines so that I can reference them. Then grabbed a straight edge. In this case, I'm using a clamping straight edge. And I get it in position. And now what I'm going to do is I want to make sure that I know how far away from the edge I need it for the router, so I have that set up on yet another tri-square. I go ahead and double check those, and now I know for a fact that when I run my router up against that straight edge, it's going to be exactly where I want it. And with that done, then it's a matter of just grabbing the router, slowly dropping it down into place. And now, well, we've sped this up a little bit, but we're going to go ahead and make the groove. Obviously, I wish it could go this fast, but it's not going to. The main thing is take your time so that you don't mess up when you get to those ends, because the last thing you want to do is to blow right through the marks that you made for the start and stop. And then just simply flip it around, check those measurements, and go from there.
So what we're going to do now is we're going to glue up the panel between the legs. And what I want to do is I want to have a quarter inch reveal on the back side here. So to help me achieve that, rather than trying to put the panel in place and then lift it to get it try and move it into the position, I've set down a quarter inch piece of plywood. And then now when I set the panel in place, it's floating up above that quarter inch mark, so I have it exactly where I want it. Now, it helps, of course, if you make sure that your panel, the quarter inch panel, is narrower than the panel that you're gluing in place, but that's really easy. Just, if necessary, rip it on the table saw or whatever you choose to do, whether a bandsaw or whatever. So, because I need to glue both sides of this, what I'm going to do is, to make it really simple, rather than rushing through, I'm going to do one side at a time. Of course, that can kind of kill our time frame, but you know what? We get a really decent result, and the end result is what's most important. One thing we're really concerned about when it comes to applying the glue is applying too much, because we don't want it dripping all over, especially if you're planning on staining it. Now, this one I'm not planning on staining. I'm just going to be putting on some amber shellac. So if there was any glue spillover, I mean, I can take it off with my scraper, or I can, you know, knock it off with a chisel, and it wouldn't really affect the overall color. But I really want to avoid it as much as possible. When it comes down to it, applying glue is an issue of applying just enough. Sometimes we go a little overkill. So I've got this in place using my handy dandy finger, and we'll just simply drop it in. Now, like I said, we're only going to be doing the one side, so it kind of helps out with the glue up itself. So, okay, now what I'm doing down here is I'm just taking a straight edge and butting it up to the top of the panel and the top of the leg to make sure that they're both exactly in the same plane. And again, this is a lot easier since we're only gluing up one leg at this time. So now that those are in place, for the moment, we'll go ahead and we'll apply our first clamp. We'll snug this up, and then what we're going to do is we're going to double check to make sure that it's where it is. And I'm pushing down to make sure that it's nice and flat on that quarter inch panel. Don't need a lot of glue pressure because the joint line is nice and tight, and this is pretty much on its way. So now we'll just simply apply some more clamps along the edge, and this panel is done. At this point in the build project, we went ahead and we just completed cutting the grooves for the adjustable shelving hardware. And of course, as we run into all the time with router bits, the ends of the grooves are rounded over. It's nearly impossible to get a square end from a router bit. If you took a very small diameter one, you could probably make it look very square, but in fact, it would actually be rounded. So what we need to do is we need to square up those corners so that the adjustable hardware will fit in the groove itself from one end to the other. Now, I went ahead and I already did this. I kind of got a little ahead of myself in the project. It often happens when you're building something on commission. So I went ahead and I did this. But let's come over to the workbench and let's talk a little bit about a couple of just tiny details when it comes to squaring up these corners, because there's a few things that can make it really, really easy or really, really hard. So let's talk about it for a second. When it comes to squaring up a corner, like I said, unfortunately with a router bit, we're always going to have some sort of rounded end, and we want to get it nice and square. So the main thing we need to do is come in with our chisels and do the work for us. Now, you might be a little thinking that you could do something like this with the corner chisel accessory that we just recently featured not too long ago. This works great when it comes to mortises, but when it comes to a deeper groove like the one we have here, it'll score the surface, but it's not going to get down as deep as you really want it to. So to get started, we need to make two cuts. We're going to go with the grain, with, you know, as the edges, the sides of the groove, and then of course we're going to want a stop cut where we're going to define the top and bottom of the groove. What I like to do is I like to start by defining the top and the bottom. And my main reason for this is it's very easy if we overcut the sides going with the grain for the grain to split wide open. It's much easier to make a cut on a ripping motion than it is on a cross cut. So what I'll end up doing first is, like I said, I make my cross cut mark to get us to define the end, the top and the bottom. And then that's when I'll come in with my chisel and do the long grain, going with the grain cuts. One thing I do want to recommend is, oh, it's a little dusty, I gotta clean this workbench up. I like using my smaller chisels when it comes to this versus using the larger one. You know, a lot of people would say, oh, if you use the larger one, you can take a bigger blow with it, you'll get more material out of the way. And it's very true, you will. But often when it comes to these corner cuts, it's not that much material that we need to get out of the way. And to be honest with you, sometimes the problem with a bigger chisel is that it's a brute and it's going to just take away too much. And on top of it, you're not going to have as much control over it because you get the weight moving on this and it's going to get away from you at some point. So for myself, at least, I like to use the smaller ones. If I have to make a couple of passes, if I have to inch it over a little bit to make the line as clean as possible, well, that's what I end up having to do. But I feel like I get a better result, a more controlled result, by using a smaller chisel. So in the case of this groove, it's approximately around 5/8 of an inch. I don't have a 5/8 inch chisel. I have a 1/2 inch chisel, and then I have a 3/4 inch chisel. So I go with the smaller one, and then I just simply bump it over to where it needs to be to complete the cut. Now, once we've defined the shoulders of the corner itself, the one on the with the grain and the one across the grain, and we drop the chisel down in there, it's really easy just to kind of come in and we'll simulate this a little bit. We drop the chisel down from the we start at the end, and then we'll drop it from the side, and then once we've managed to get it down to that final depth, we just simply, what I like to do is turn the bevel over so the bevel is facing down. And then I can kind of come in and I'll clean the material out and just kind of pop it out a little bit. And that's how I get it out. And the end result is not too bad. Now, when we take a look at this one, they don't look like the cleanest, but once I get the hardware in place, you're not going to see it and the job is completed. One of the beauties of custom furniture, building our own pieces, is the fact that we have quite a few options. Now, whether the option is tweaking a design to make it more of our own or to fit with existing pieces that we have, whether it's choosing the materials we're going to work with, perhaps we want only solid wood or we want nothing but plywood with maybe some veneer on the edges or a mixture of them, or maybe you want to work with MDF, whatever. You have a whole bunch of options. And along with those options also becomes options for hardware. Now, as we saw in today's first part of this project, we went ahead and routed a groove in which that adjustable shelf strip is going to fit into, and then we'll use the clips and we'll be able to move those to whatever height that we need for the shelves. Now, it's a really easy way to do it, and I think I mentioned the fact that I really like it because they seem to be a little bit more solid. I think they can really stand up to a lot of wear and tear. One thing that's really important when you put those in place is to make sure that if you need to cut them, like I ended up doing for this project, you want to make sure that they're cut at the same length, so therefore when you put them in place, they'll match up exactly the same way. And it's not just on one side, you want to make it sure it's true on both sides. So what you would really need is 4 pieces that are exactly the same in every way imaginable. Now, the other options that we have, of course, and I think we're most familiar with these, are these little shelf supports. And I'll make sure to come in here really tight so you can get a look at this. We have basically the shelf support where it looks kind of like a spoon on one end, and then it has the post that would stick into a hole that you would drill into the side of the shelf side. And then you have another one that's probably really familiar with. Again, you have a post, and you essentially have an L bracket that the shelf would sit on. couple of options with these is you can have them exposed on the bottom, or you could go as far as to cut a little groove in the bottom of the shelf so that when it sits on top of it, they're hidden. One thing when it comes to using supports much like these, we need to make sure that we drill holes that are evenly spaced, again, on not just on one side, but on both sides. So you have four sets of holes that you need to make sure are absolutely evenly spaced so that you don't get any kind of bowing or twisting, or you don't want it to kind of have the shelf so that anything on it could roll downhill. I mean, maybe you do, maybe that's part of your design, but for the majority of us, I don't think we want to do something like that. We'll talk about jigs in just a second. I want to cover one more thing, but we'll talk about a couple of jigs that we could look at that would help us to make those holes accurate each and every single time, assuming you set them up the right way. But along the lines of these posts, these are just the really basic ones that we have, like I said, kind of the spoon and then the L-bracket version. Now, this is a new one that I've been seeing on the market, and I know the folks over at Popular Woodworking talked about it, and again, we'll get a close-up on this. I happened to ask the folks over at Lee Valley if I could borrow one of these to take a look at it. And what really is unique about this one is, again, you just have the basic post that would stick into the hole that you would drill in your side. But as you'll see when we get close-up on this, the head of it isn't really... it's not a uniform size. It's not symmetrical all the way around. In fact, it's rather asymmetrical, and it has this nice little groove in the face of it. Now, what you can do is, as I mentioned, one of the problems that we'd be concerned with if our holes weren't evenly drilled, spaced out, I should say, is that the shelf could kind of wobble a little bit, or maybe when we cut the material for what would be our shelf, in between the time that we cut it and when we finally assembled it, maybe it warped a little bit. You know, it got a little twist in it or something. Well, using an adjuster like this one, you would put it in place, and then what you could do is once you get the shelf set, if you notice that there's any wobble in there, you just set a screwdriver in here, and you can turn this, and what it does is it will actually adjust to the height to help even out that shelf wiggleness. Now, wiggleness? That shelf wobble. This is really fantastic, especially for, I think, most of us who are home woodworkers, who this is something that we do on the side. Because let's get serious. Sometimes when we start a project, we have to set it aside, and things are just going to happen. And unfortunately, wobbly shelves tend to be one of the things that I run into quite a bit. No matter what I do to get around it, there's always a little bit of wobble. And there are ways that we can fix that using the materials that we have on hand if we didn't have these little things. But having these new spiral adjusters, they work really, really great. And it's super simple, like I said, just to adjust it so that it comes up and meets the height that's, you know, having the little bit of a wobble in there. One thing the manufacturer would recommend is that you, on the end of the shelf itself, you might want to hide this, so you would drill a small hole. And the nice thing with that, though, is still, if you preferably, you would drill it with the smaller side. I'm not explaining this really well, but when you then turn it, it would come up and adjust for that wobble, and then it would be hidden. Like I said, the folks over at Popular Woodworking did a blog entry about this, Glenn Huey did, and then on top of it, I know for a fact that they put a video out regarding this, so I'll try to make sure I have links in the show notes so that you can get a look at this, because it's a really neat feature, and to be quite honest with you, these might almost become regular staples here in Matt's Basement Workshop. I mean, they work fantastic from what I've been able to see. Another option, again along the line of a clip, once in a while we might want to make a project where we have a glass shelf. And the one thing with the glass shelves is obviously they're really beautiful, and whatever support you choose to go with, you definitely will, if you do everything right, if you get the holes spaced out evenly, you shouldn't have any issues. But one thing I notice with glass shelves is the fact that when you're opening and closing the case, or perhaps for a big guy like myself, you're walking across the floor, you'll get some vibration, and then the shelf may actually eventually work itself off of the clips or the supports. And, you know, you can only imagine what would happen then. So what we have here is we have, again, one that has the post on it, but it has this nice adjustable little arm on it that comes down and will hold the glass in place, or a mirror, if you're using maybe a mirrored shelf. and it's going to hold it nice and snug, so therefore you don't have to worry about the possibility of it coming off, crashing down, and ruining whatever it was supporting. So I think that this is a really neat thing. Now, it has a nice little pad on it, so you don't have to worry about it breaking the glass, and you don't have to really tighten these super hard. You just snug it on there enough, friction will do the rest, and you're all set. One more variation that we have here as an example of hardware is this neat little wire hanger. Now, what this does is, this is one that really, if you wanted to, you could simply drill the holes, the corresponding holes. You'd have to match them to the length here. You could put it in place and then set the shelf on top of it. Or what it's really meant to do is, these are meant to be hidden. So you would take the shelf end. You would then dado in a groove corresponding to this, which is about, I'm going to say it's about an eighth of an inch or so, maybe more like a 3/16, I guess it would be. I probably should have measured it before I talked about it. But then once this is in place, you can take that shelf and you can slide it right over the top of this. It's completely hidden, so it looks like the shelf is practically just floating there. And you can see how that would be really nice, because it would give you those nice clean lines, so that it, especially if you're working with a piece that's more of a modern style look, you don't have to worry about matching up the hardware whatsoever. And again, this would really help out if you had any wobble in the shelf, because as the shelf comes across the top of it, this is really supporting the whole length. So, you know, it would help to kind of take some of that twist out. Now, I'm kind of grasping a little bit straws there, because if you have really bad twist, obviously it's not going to be able to help you that much. And if you had a real big cup in there, you could see how potentially there could be an issue with it. But still, overall, if you have really flat shelves, this one will really help you out quite a bit. And to cut the groove for this, really you could use a slot cutting router bit, or the one thing I was thinking is, you could take your biscuit joiner, your plate joiner, and go along and you could cut the slot in the end grain of the shelf, and that would fit right on there rather nicely. I don't know if I would recommend doing it on a table saw. That makes me a little nervous, because especially depending on the length of the shelf, it's just, with it being hidden, I really don't recommend you doing that. Maybe with a router with a straight bit. Again, on a router table with the height of the shelf, I'm a little not so happy about that. But if you could come up with a really safe jig where you could do it freehand, maybe that might be an option for you. But anyways, though, regardless, we have all these neat hardware options, and I'm sure there's a few more out there that we could be talking about, but I just wanted to kind of share these with you. Again, thanks to the folks over at Lee Valley for letting me borrow these and give everybody a look at it. Now, before we wrap up the episode today, I know it's running a little bit longer, I want to show you a couple of jigs that we could use to create those evenly spaced holes that all of these ones that are essentially one version of a post support, how we can set out those holes nice and evenly and get them accurate pretty much every single time. So let's take a look at those next. So of course, regardless of which hardware we go with, as I mentioned, a lot of them are the post versions, and if we're going to use the post, we need to make sure that we have evenly spaced holes that are pretty much exactly where we need them every single time, and so therefore we want a reliable system. And this was one of the first manufactured jigs that I purchased. In fact, this was the first manufactured jig that I purchased. It's from Woodhaven, woodhaven.com. I'm not even sure if they're still in business. Maybe we should get a hold of them. It'd be really cool if we get some to give away. But really, as you can see, this is nothing more than just a length of a material with some holes that are evenly spaced out already by the manufacturer. Now, over here on the side, we'll flip this over. We have these two pegs, which essentially act as a registration to the side of the material that I'm working on. So I would just take this, bump it right up against it, and then now I have the holes spaced at a certain distance in. Now, as you can see, there are some limitations, because you have to go with the size that they have already predetermined for you, but it's actually far enough in that it would really work perfectly fine for what we want to do. Now, when you do something like this, of course, the main thing is that we need to have registration lines on the material that we're working with, so that we know exactly where to start, both on the front and the back, and then, again, we're going to do it on the opposite one. But we're not going to get into that whole thing right now. Maybe we'll come back and talk about that in another episode. But to use a jig like this, this one I use a router. I have a nice bushing that would fit directly into this hole, and it fits nice and snug, so it's not going anywhere. depending on the size of the post that I'm using, I could use like a quarter inch or a 1/8 inch straight bit, or preferably a spiral cut router bit, one with an upstroke so that it's going to pull the material out of the way. I'd get this bushing loaded up onto my router. I would then get this into position, clamp it down, because I need to have clamps to hold it in, and then I could just simply come in, and once I've got everything registered, drop the bushing in place, drop the router bit down to the predetermined depth that I need, and then I can come along and then go through each one of these holes, or I could even potentially skip every other hole, however it is that I want my configuration. And then, if perhaps the stock is longer than the jig is, one thing I can do is there's this nice little peg that they have, and when you get down to the last hole, you just simply unclamp, you would move the jig down, put this little peg in there, in the very first one, and then you could, actually, you'd probably want to put it more like in the second one. Well, you could do it in the first. Anyways, regardless, we're getting away from it. Put it in, and it acts like a registration so that, again, they would still continue to be evenly spaced. Push it up against there, keep that in place, clamp it down, and then we'll come back with our router, and then go through all of them and make it to the length that we need. So that's a really neat option to have. And again, you can use it with the router, or you could use it with a drill, but to be honest with you, the problem with the drill is that you could potentially start damaging these holes, which I had done at one point with a really bad bushing. Now, another option that we have is something like this. This is part of the Veritas 32 cabinet system. In fact, this is the basic model that they have. It comes with the one bar here with all of the holes evenly spaced out. It has this really unique clamping system that I think is pretty cool, because essentially it's two threaded rods, and it has these clamps that you would just simply get them on either side of the material that you're working with, your shelf sides, and then you can snug them so it essentially holds it from the sides rather than to have clamps that hold it down to the surface, so you don't have to worry about being like on an edge of a workbench and using a traditional clamp to hold it in place. And they hold pretty snug. Now, another thing that they do is once you get your registration marks lined up, you know exactly where the holes are, and you can kind of usually look through the holes on the bar itself. You then just simply tighten down these knurled knobs, and you now know that this is not going where. In fact, we'll snug that up, and really seriously, I'm not playing. You cannot move this. So this is, like I said, just the basic system. You then have a bushing sled, I guess is what you could really call it, has the bushing through it. You would then drop that over the top of the first hole that you want to work with. You would then use the appropriate sized drill bit that you need with a collet on, of course, to stop you from going all the way through. And then once you drilled your first hole, you could then move it to the next one, and then you'd move it down to the next one, and so on. Again, you can space it out however you need to. And again, just like with the other one, if we need to move it down, what you would do then is when you get to that last hole, you have a nice little registration peg here. You would then drop it in place. You can move the system down, and it will, as long as you don't move these right here, these two knurled knobs that kind of hold it in place in the bars, just loosen the threaded rods up a little bit, move it down, and it's going to keep on registering. Of course, once you move it down just a little bit more, you might want to double check to make sure that it's squared off how you want it on your registration lines, because I always recommend you have registration lines there. And then again, you can continue going down the line with this. Now, as I said, this is their basic system. The more advanced system, essentially you have a second a jig bar in here that again has all the areas for the threaded rods, and it has the knurled knobs on it. And then to help you with making adjustments from the top, so maybe you just want to just fine adjust it here and there, rather than simply having to rely on these bars or your little registration marks, you then have this system which clamps up at the top and essentially clamps onto each one of these bars here to snug in place. And this will then, again, help you to make your marks, as you can fine-tune it up and down It comes with some longer threaded rods to, in case you're working with wider material. And again, it just gives you more options. And I'm even told that you can use this system, if you buy the full system or just get some of the accessories to go with it, this also can work as a doweling jig. So, something to think about. But anyways, though, I'll have links in the show notes so you can get a better look at these. I really couldn't go into too much detail about the systems just because there's a lot to do it, and we'd have to dedicate a whole show to that. So maybe we'll come back and talk a little bit more about it and do some examples and get a feel for how to actually use these. One more jig I'm gonna talk about, and I know we're really running long here today, but a long time ago received a jig from a listener of the show, and this was back on our old website. And so I'm going to have a link for this. I think it was Don Gardner, I think is who it is. I don't have it in front of me at the moment, but I will make sure to have links to it to give you all the information. He sent in a fantastic PDF that explains how to make your own system, kind of similar to this one right here from Woodhaven. Again, using the holes, using just a basic router or a drill bit with a nice depth set on it, and you get really fantastic results from it. And again, it's something you can make right there in your own home. So a nice little homemade jig for doing this right here. So hopefully this is giving you an idea of some of the options that you have and giving you an idea of how to go about doing these things. This is one thing I definitely want to do from this point out is each time we're doing one of these build projects, whatever segment we have, hopefully I'm going to talk about something from that segment to give you a better idea of how it can help you with the project if you're going to build it or if you're building a similar project. But anyways, though, like I said, we've run a little bit long here. So I will be talking to all of you later. If you have comments, questions, some great suggestions or anything, stop by the website, mattsbasementworkshop.com. You can click on the links there for any of the things that I've talked about in today's show. And, of course, you can send me questions at mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com. And, of course, you can find links at the website, too, for doing that. And don't forget to get yourself entered for the free swag, because we give away swag every single month. So why can't you win something? Well, unless you don't get entered, you're not going to have a chance to. So check out the swag page, find out what's up and available for it, and get yourself entered each month. So without further ado, I think I'm going to call it a day. And coming up next week, we'll have the second half of the build project, and we'll be moving on from there. So until then, straight grains and sharp blades. Take care, everybody.
Thanks for watching. For more information on today's episode, visit mattsbasementworkshop.com. And a huge thanks to our sponsors, Highland Woodworking and Lee Valley. Visit them today.